come, even so. Just like you said, even so. I come quickly, even so. Even so. Come, Lord Jesus. Now, while you may remember this, it's good to recall again the centrality of the second coming of Christ. This is not an addendum. The second coming of Christ is not like an optional series of studies or area of exploration. It's very essential. It's wrapped up. Paul gives in Hebrews 9, I know some people don't think Paul wrote the book of Hebrews, but they'll find out. He summarized Christ in a few verses, his whole ministry, in Hebrews 9, 24 through 26, and he summarized it in capturing three different appearances. For Christ has not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself now, to appear in the presence of God for us. So the sequence he follows is not first, second, third. He starts out where he is now, because you need to know where he is now to take advantage of the rest. Amen. Nor yet that he should offer himself often as the high priest entereth into the holy place every year, for then must he have suffered often since the foundation of the world. Once he entered into the world to put away sin, just once. But the second time he's going to appear without sin. Amen. Without dealing with sin. It doesn't mean Jesus is coming in without him having sin. He never did have sin. So he's not coming to deal with sin or to fight the Antichrist,
yeah, right,
or to deal with wayward people, or to set up a rule over the ungodly. Uh-huh. That's all dealing with sin. Mm-hmm. See, so the second time, that's the wrap up.
Yeah.
And so he summarized Christ by talking about his three appearances, now, in the end of the world, once in the end of the world, uh-huh, and the second time. That wraps. See, that shows you the centrality of the second coming of Christ.
Yeah.
It's ranked in there with him appearing to put away sin. You know how important that is. It ranks with him presently interceding for us. You know how important that is. That's what he ranks to the coming of Christ with. In Titus, he summarized for us the grace of God. There's a lot of loose talk about the grace of God. Titus 2:11 to 13, the grace of God that bringeth salvation, that's the grace we're talking about now, the grace that brings salvation, hath appeared to all men. That is, anyone who wants to can see this.
Yeah.
This is not like a private thing.
Yeah.
It's what the grace of God that brings salvation is teaching us, to that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, deny me, rejecting. We should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and Savior Jesus Christ. You've got to maintain this posture. You've got to reject anything that's tainted.
Amen.
Got to reject that. That's not enough. You got to look forward to the coming of the Lord, anticipating it. Jesus said to the churches from Asia and to us as well, Revelation 16:15, behold, fasten your eyes on this, pay attention to this, I'm coming like a thief. Blessed is he that watches, keeps his garments, that lest he walk naked and they see his shame. See, all the pretense, the religious pretense, political pretense, social pretense, it's all going to be stripped off when Jesus comes.
Amen.
Again. Everybody's going to be seen exactly like they are.
Amen.
going to be downright embarrassing for anybody but the saints.
That's right.
Amen.
Jesus is coming as a thief.
Right.
He's not going to let anybody keep something that's not eternal.
Amen.
Guys, if you're not able to look forward to that, well, you got to adjust your adjust your vision. Showing how the centrality, how the central the coming of Christ is. Again, Revelation 22:7. Behold, I come quickly, suddenly, unexpectedly. Blessed is he that keeps the prophecies of this book. That's the revelation, is the this book. Keeps them, being done, forget them. Ponders them. Oh, a lot of people have, they purposely ignore the book of Revelation.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Because of what other people have said about it.
Uh-huh.
I'm coming quickly, suddenly, there won't be any time to adjust.
Amen.
When I begin my descent, so to speak, there's not going to be any time to get ready. Whatever state you're in, that's it. You're locked into it. Keep the sayings of this book. Sayings that tell you to come out from her, my people.
Yeah.
Pay attention to that now. Pay attention to that.
Mm-hmm.
Be thou faithful unto death. Pay attention to that.
Uh-huh.
I'm just showing you the centrality of Christ appearing. Now, we've dealt with some of these things, but I want to touch upon them briefly, but introductory manner. The various contexts of Christ's coming. The kind of framework of thought in which the second coming of Christ is to be considered. See, there's a certain mindset that people have to have when they think about the coming of Christ. You can't be thinking about it at last, we're going to have a good earthly kingdom. This is not the proper mindset.
Amen.
He's going to decimate all the kingdoms of the world.
Yes.
So let's think about this. The various contexts in which the coming of Christ is considered. Now here's one in 1 Corinthians 1:7. Paul tells him why he's writing. So that you come behind in no gift, that is, you've got adequate. The people of Corinth had received adequate gifts and spiritual aptitudes to get ready for the end of the world. Now, they did a very bad job in handling them. But then he adds this. You came behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. So you've got this aptitude. Everybody has some kind of aptitude for Christ. It's in Christ. So everybody has some kind of aptitude. There's something you can do. But while you're doing it, you're waiting for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The church really isn't the main thing. The gifts the church has isn't the main. They aren't the main thing. Main thing is his coming. Here's another. This is the context in which the coming of Christ is realized. 1 Thessalonians 3:13. To the end, or that's for this objective, we'd say, that he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God, even the Father, at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints.
Yeah.
There it is laid out for you. This is the objective, that when Jesus comes, you will be unblameable.
Yeah.
Amen.
Now, you're going to have to work at this. Paul said that's why he preached unblameable. I want to present you unblameable. Here's its emphasis again, 1 Thessalonians 5:23. Very God of peace, sanctify you wholly, and I pray God your whole spirit, soul, and body may be preserved blameless.
Amen.
Under the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Blame. Do you have any blame tonight? We're not talking about things we can blame you for.
Yeah, yeah.
Is there something God can blame you for tonight? You have some kind of spot, some kind of a moral or spiritual spot, some kind of inadequacy, some kind of defilement. You've got to address that thing.
Amen.
You can't live with it. You can't live with it.
Amen.
You've got to be blameless when Jesus comes. That's done hour by hour and day by day. So you got to confess your sins, faithful just to forgive your sins. You got to abstain from ungodliness and worldly lust. You've got to maintain that status. Tonight, when you go to bed, you can go to bed blameless.
Amen.
Amen.
You confess to the Lord all of if you wonder whether it's inadequate or not, then confess it. Don't take any chances. Confess it. You can be blameless.
Yes.
So if Jesus comes tonight, you'll be ready.
Amen.
You don't want to not be ready when Jesus comes. He's not going to say, well, I'll give you time. You know, here in the world, we get running a little late once in a while, and someone says, well, I'll give you time. I'll wait for you. See, Jesus isn't going to do that.
Amen.
And the glorious news, good news is everything required to do that is supply. We're not talking about just like gutting it out.
Mm-hmm.
We're not talking about that. Here's another context. So there's the context, blamelessness. Here's another. Beseeching or pleading with people. 2 Thessalonians 2:1. We beseech you, brethren. We're begging you.
Yes.
We're pleading with you. By the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together to him, we're begging you. See, I wish I was better at this. I wish I was better at begging people. Pleading with people. Because Jesus is coming. We've only got so long to be pleading.
Amen.
Trying to convince people. Reasoning with people. Trying to persuade people. We've only got so long to do it.
Yes.
The coming of Christ is injected into that kind of consideration. Beseeching. And James, he puts it in the context of endurance. You know, so far all these things, there are things that are, they're not accomplished. They're in a state of being accomplished. This is James 5:7. Be patient, be enduring. Being patient, that doesn't mean just pretend like nothing's happening. Be patient, therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord Jesus. Keep running till keep handling the abuse until then. Be patient, therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman waiteth for the precious fruit of the earth, and hath long patience for it, until he receive the early and latter rain. See, God, Jesus, well, Jesus said his Father is the husbandman. My Father is the husbandman. Now, he's waiting for some good fruit from you. He's patient. He's enduring.
Uh-huh.
Now, you got to be patient, too.
Yes.
If you don't see the kind of fruit, just keep where the fruit grows.
Yeah.
Keep in the state where fruitfulness happens.
Yeah.
Don't get into an area where fruitfulness doesn't happen.
Uh-huh.
Don't let something kill your fruit,
yeah,
or like our spiritual blight.
Uh-huh.
See, this mentions the coming of the Lord in that kind of context, endurance. Then Peter, he talks about the coming of the Lord in the context of the end of the world.
Yeah.
Looking for and hasting unto.
Uh-huh.
That we're running toward Christ.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Maybe today.
Yeah.
You're running toward it. The coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved. The elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens.
Yeah.
And a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, looking at seeing you look for such things, you look mean anticipate. You're anticipating this. Be diligent that you may be found in him in peace. When you're in the presence of God, like how do you feel?
Yes.
Are you agitated? Well, some of us experience this. I don't deny this, but. You don't want to be in a position where when you are conscious of God's presence, you're scared.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Amen.
Salvation can address that.
Amen.
You are to be found in him without spot and blameless. And if you are without spot and blameless, which the blood of Christ can keep you that way. See, if you walk in the light as he is in the light, the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses you from all sin. And account the long-suffering of our Lord as salvation. As long as Jesus hasn't come, the door's open. Consider that. There's the coming of the Lord in the context of the destruction of the world. See the sobriety of all of these things? Here's another. Receiving praise from God. You want someone to think well of you, do you? And you should.
Yeah.
Nobody welcomes disapproval.
Yeah. That's right.
It's not a pleasant thing. Let's not kid anybody about this. But if you get approval from God, see, that'll offset.
Yes.
That'll offset everything else.
Amen.
Here it is, 1 Corinthians 4:5. Therefore, judge nothing before the time. Don't make any final decisions on people yet. Until the Lord come, who will bring to light both the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsels of the heart. And then shall every man, it's every faithful man he's talking about,
yeah. Uh-huh.
And woman, have praise from God. Now listen,
yeah.
That's worth waiting for.
Amen.
If you look for praise from men are fickle. They praise you today and criticize you tomorrow.
That's right.
Accept you today, reject you tomorrow. That's the way it is in the world. That's the way it is. Do what I want and I'll accept you. Don't do what I want and I'll criticize you. That's the way it is in the world. Now how it is with God, he saves it all up to the end. And then publicly,
yeah,
before your critics,
yes,
God's going to say he or she was right,
mm-hmm,
and your critics were wrong.
Amen.
And we're talking about eternal penalties and eternal blessings there. See, so that's the context in which Christ's second coming is considered.
Amen.
Matthew 16:27 gives you another one. I'm showing you the importance of Christ's return. Matthew 16:27, the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and he shall reward every man according to his works. So whatever you've done with your life that's between you and the Lord, whatever you've done with your life, he's going to bring an appropriate reward for that.
Yes.
Amen.
He's the one that's going to determine it. There's two kinds of rewards. Here it is again. I'm showing you the context of Christ, in which Christ's coming is considered. Matthew 25:13. Watch therefore. Ye know neither the day nor the hour when the Son of Man cometh. You don't know when Jesus is going to come. You don't know.
Yeah.
Nobody else does either.
Amen. Yeah.
Sometime back, you know, a man predicted it was the third time he'd made a prediction. He predicted the exact day when Jesus was going to come. Well, the day come, and he gave us.
Yeah.
So you don't know, and it's on purpose.
Amen.
God knows the day, but he has. Even the Son of God has chosen not to know it.
That's right.
Because he's identifying with us. See?
Right.
Again, there's the judgment that's connected with Christ's coming.
Yeah.
Matthew 25:31 tells you, remember, all the nations are going to be gathered before him. He'll separate them from one another as a shepherd divideth the goat, and he shall set the sheep on the right hand, the goats on the left, and the judgment's going to begin. That's how you think of Christ coming. Some people think of Christ coming as a time of a marvelous, optimized kingdom on earth. That's how they think about it. But Jesus said, don't think about it that way. Think about it as the final separation of those that are and those that aren't. sons of God. Sometimes it's hard to tell. Huh? It's hard to tell who's the sheep and who's the goat.
Yeah.
Some people, some people it's evident. Some people live so close to God, there's no question about where they are. Some people, you can't tell.
Mm-hmm.
But it's going to be told when Jesus comes again.
Yes, amen.
He's going to stay in heaven till all things are fulfilled that were spoken by the prophets. That's Acts 3:21. Prophets said a lot. The prophets talked about the end of the world. They talked about the resurrection of the dead. They talked about the day of judgment. Jesus not leaving until all those are fulfilled.
Yeah.
I'm showing you the context in which the coming of the Lord has been presented. And then there's the Lord's table. So if you take, eat this flesh and drink this, eat this bread, drink this cup, you show forth. Show forth means you proclaim. The Lord's death till he come.
Amen.
See, at this table, we're declaring Christ died, and so did I.
Yeah.
I died with him.
Yeah.
I died to the world with him. We're declaring that. See, if anyone has any questions about it, watch how we live. Now, if we're not able to say that, then get to a position where you can say that. Be followers of me. You want to know how to get to God?
Uh-huh.
Follow me. Do what, live like I'm living. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if I want to live that way. No, how bad do you want to go to heaven?
Amen.
Find someone that's anxious to go and follow them.
Yeah.
I don't mean have the same occupation they have or stuff like that. That's not what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about live with that kind of an awareness. Where you don't divorce anything you're doing from God.
Amen.
Nothing at all. Any coming to the Lord's associated with receiving an immortal body. Called a glorious body. Philippians 3:20 and 21. Our conversation or manner of life is in heaven. From whence we also look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body. Some versions say the body of our humiliation. That is, we're ashamed of the body we got now.
Yeah.
Why? Because it looks bad? No, that's not what he's talking about.
Uh-huh.
But this body decays.
Yeah, uh-huh.
It's going downhill.
Yeah.
Miss America today is not going to be Miss America 10 years, 20 years from now.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
It's not going to happen. See, it's body's going down.
Uh-huh.
That's the context on which Christ's coming is, is placed.
Yeah.
And the mortifying of the body, deeds of the body, putting to death what the body wants to do. That's another way of saying you refuse to let the body do what it kind of demands to do.
Yeah.
You are dead and your life is hid with Christ in God, Colossians 3:3. You are dead to the world, dead to sin, dead to Satan, dead. You're dead, your life is hid with Christ in God, and when Christ, who is our life, shall appear. See, there it is again. There's the context of Christ's appearance. And it's the objective of the saved. You turn to God from idols to serve the living God and to wait for a son from heaven. See? Converts who aren't told about Christ coming again haven't been told the whole gospel.
That's right.
I've showed you how the context in which Christ's coming. See, all of them are very important, and all of them are central, and all of them have a note of finality about them, so that no one should have any question about how serious the coming of the Lord is. And then there's this, throughout Scripture, the certainty of his coming.
Yeah.
The certainty of it. Jesus said, I will come again.
Amen.
John 14:3. I will come again. I will come again. I will come again. I will come again. See it? 2 Peter 3:10, the day of the Lord will come.
Yeah.
See the certainty of it. Four different texts say the Son of Man shall come. Jesus said, in an hour that you think not, the Son of Man comes.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And again, he said, when he comes. See, so it's a certainty. Certainty of his coming. Now, this being the case, I showed you how it's central, the context in which it's mentioned, the certainty of the coming of the Lord. Now, how ought we to live in view of this? Peter said, seeing that these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness? All right, what kind of people should we be? Be good to kind of sometimes just have an open forum, just kind of discuss this, you know.
Yeah.
What kind of people should you be? Jesus said this, Luke 12:36, and ye yourselves like unto men that wait for their Lord when he will return from the wedding, that when he cometh and knocketh, they may open unto him immediately. So that's how we should live. That when he comes, we'll be able to immediately open the door and say, here am I. I'm ready, Lord. I'm ready. You, some people are going to run and hide. This is just the truth. Don't let it be you. Jesus said in Matthew 24:43, know this, the governor of the house, if he had known what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Even in the world, people, that they know. Is your house going to be broken up when Jesus comes? Are your plans all going to be down the tube when Jesus comes? You got to think this out. I can't. I got enough thinking about it for myself. I can't think it out for anybody else. Do I want to spend my life on something that I'm going to grieve that it went down, went away? Is this what I'm going to do with my life? Everybody's got to make up their mind here. Our job is just to exhort people and hope they'll exhort me too. To be ready for this appearing of the Lord, so your house isn't broken up.
Yeah.
See, the house on the sand was busted up.
Yeah.
Guess what Jesus said? He built their house on the sand, and then the floods came, and winds blew, and it fell. Well, that's the floods and all, it's coming when Jesus comes again.
Yeah.
Don't let your house be broken up. Don't be found sleeping. Mark 13:35, watch therefore, for ye know not when the master of the house cometh, at even or at midnight, or the cock crowing in the morning, lest coming suddenly he find you sleeping. Mm-hmm. you dozed off. You forgot he was coming. You got up in the morning, you lived the day with your own plans in mind. You forgot. He's going to come. What's going to happen if he finds you sleeping? You're out.
Yeah.
What's going to happen if you're not sleeping? You're in. Now, this doesn't mean that you live an ignorement of earthly responsibilities and all this sort of thing. That's not what it means. It means that in them, you take firmly a hold of Christ's hands and you do it clinging to him with purpose of heart.
Yes.
And then one last thing in 1 Thessalonians 5:6, therefore let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. Sober. Alert. Know what's going on round about you. Able to pick up on the signs of the times. So forth. Alert. Then you got to ask yourself, why am I doing the things I do? Maybe sometimes some alert soul may ask you this. They may say, why are you doing? Why are you living that way? Why are you doing this? Don't get angry with them if they say this. Don't say, who are you? Who are you? Who are you to judge? Don't say, well, now that you mentioned it, I will assess what I'm doing. See, some people don't really assess what they're doing. They don't pay attention to where they're going. They don't look at where they're at. They don't think about how they're spending the resources God has given them. They just forget about all that. Well, the coming of the Lord is in the context of you not being unaware. So then our text says, even so, come quickly. Lord Jesus. Now let me give you some of Christ's words before he said that. It's Revelation 22:16. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel. Whoa, think about that. I, Jesus, have sent my angel unto you to testify to you these things in the churches. See? Tell the churches these things. I'm the root and offspring of David and the bright and morning star. I'm the one that everything's about.
Yeah. Amen.
Verse 17, the Spirit and the bride say, come. See, this is the same. And let him that heareth say, come. Let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. See, so what do you, that's what he said before this call that he's going to come. He tells everybody, listen up. Next two verses, Revelation 2:18 and 19. For I testify to everyone that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, which is the book of the Revelation. If any man shall add unto these things, boy, the church world has added to this book, I'll tell you. Here's God's word to him. If any man shall add to these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. So that's, everyone has been made alert now.
Amen.
That goes for someone that ignores what's said in this book.
Yes.
Don't ignore it. Now, right after that, he says, he that testifies these things says, surely I come quickly. I'm coming quickly. I'm coming suddenly. I'm coming unexpectedly. I'm coming to judge. I'm coming to reward. I'm coming to destroy the heavens and the earth. I'm coming to gather my people to myself. I'm coming to banish the wicked. I'm coming quickly, suddenly, without delay. John answers, hopefully for everybody. Even so, just that way.
That's right. Amen.
Come, Lord Jesus. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. I have to tell you this. When he comes, it's going to interrupt your job. Are you going to do it? Not going to do it. No matter what the job is or how good it is, going to interrupt your job. You got to be able to say, even so, come. If it interrupts my job, even so, come, Lord Jesus. It's going to interrupt your schooling. Whatever age you are. You got to be ready for that. You say, even so, come, Lord Jesus, even if it interrupts my schooling or my children's schooling. Going to interrupt your family life. You're not going to have any more family life after that. When we're all going to be united in Christ, there's not going to be moms and dads and children. You know, that's not going to be. That's here for here. You got to get accustomed to God's family while you're here. As well as much as can, get your family into God's family. Because that family won't be split up. See, God, so I'm obligated to tell you that when he comes quickly, it's going to interrupt family life. It's going to interrupt your projects. I'm not saying your projects are bad. I'm just saying you got to know they're going to be interrupted.
Yes, amen.
If the ones you're working on now aren't interrupted, the ones you're working on then will be interrupted.
Yeah.
They don't take on projects that can't be interrupted. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Earthly security and interests all going to be, all our retirement plans are going to be interrupted.
Yeah, right, yeah.
I mean, you may stashed it away. We know the scriptures tell us you ought to lay up store, you know. We understand that.
Yeah.
But you got to do it with this in mind that this is going to be interrupted.
Yeah.
All the savings plans are going to be interrupted.
Yeah.
All the banks are going to be interrupted.
Uh-huh.
All the credit cards are going to be interrupted.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah, don't live like your credit card's going to last forever.
Yeah,
it's going to be interrupted.
Yeah. Amen.
Even so, come Lord Jesus. Don't live like, if you're young, don't live like you're never going to grow up.
Uh-huh.
Your youth is going to be interrupted. Don't live like when you're old age, you're going to live forever. Your old age is going to be interrupted. See, come quickly interrupts every conceivable circumstance.
Yes,
amen. Yeah.
Amen. You, having received this, you can work out your salvation with fear and trembling. The important thing is to be ready.
Amen.
Some activities mesmerize the people involved in them. They kind of put you to sleep spiritually. There's things like that. And now you have, they could be such thing as playing games. Those you invest heavily in games, your gaming will be interrupted. Got to remember this. Don't build up a stash of this kind of stuff or depend on this to keep you calm down or what. All that stuff's going to be interrupted. Behold, I'm coming quickly.
Yes.
Amen.
Blessed are those that are ready.
Amen.
Lived with that in view. I trust now that you'll be able to take this and live it out. This is your business. I'm done now with any kind of involvement with you in this project. I got to give attention to my working out my own salvation with fear and trembling, because when you reach my age, there's a bunch of other stuff you have to contend with. You didn't have to contend with that. I didn't have to contend with when I was younger, see? So I got to pay attention now. I got to be ready. Whether you're old or young, you got to be ready. If you just became a child of God, you just are kind of newly born, you got to be ready.
Yes.
Amen.
If you're an old seasoned veteran, you got to be ready.
Yes.
See?
Amen.
Be ready. He's coming quickly.
Yeah.
He's not going to shout down from heaven, are you ready now?
Uh-huh. Yes.
No, it's not going to happen. He's telling you now.
Yes.
Be ready. May our assemblies all be conducive to that end.
Amen.
Brother Gene has our exhortation.